Sergeant Sue's car pulled up outside Alvin's headquarters. He switched on his walkie-talkie and called the two plainclothesmen he had posted in the car but behind the jewelry shop. They reported they were in position. Roger, acknowledged Sergeant Sue. If anyone tries to leave, stop them. As he stepped out of his car, his shoulders slumped. He felt a heavy burden settle over him. Alvin's father had been his best friend. They'd risen through the ranks of the police force together. Then came the devastating motorcycle accident that claimed his life. When Alvin had shown an interest in detective work, Sergeant Sue was happy to encourage him. He knew that Alvin's father would have been very proud of his son's achievements. But this case was different. The kidnapping of a world-famous pop star had put the whole force in the spotlight. The global media was following every development. By interfering in the investigation, Alvin and his team could damage the image of the police as well as break the law. Sergeant Sue entered the jewelry shop where Alvin's mother sold handcrafted jewelry. To the best of his knowledge, she had never gone on dates with any other man since her husband died. When she saw the sergeant enter, she smiled. "What a surprise," she called, before noticing the expression on his face. Sergeant Sue cleared his throat. "Good morning, Gracie," he began, trying to sound as casual as possible. "Is Alvin around?" Alvin's mother turned pale. "They were all in the headquarters a minute ago," she replied, her voice dropped to a whisper. "Why, Sam, what's happened?" Sergeant Sue led the way into the bedroom. It was deserted. He glanced at all the newspaper cuttings on the central table. "Well, they're obviously on the case," he muttered. Then he noticed the stack of waiters and maid's uniform piled on a chair. He fingered one of the uniforms as he considered the best course of action. "Sam, what's the matter?" demanded Alvin's mother. "What's Alvin done now?" Sergeant Sue turned to face her. He held her arm lightly. "Gracie, you're not going to believe me if I tell you. Your son just got himself mixed up in a kidnapping case." Alvin and his team had left headquarters minutes before the police arrived. Rafe had suggested a return visit to the stadium so they would work out how Romeo had disappeared. Rocky had jumped into the back seat of one taxi with Wailing, leaving Alvin glowering at them from beside the driver. Rocky was wearing a spare pair of Alvin's jeans and one of Rafe's old army shirts, the one with a green and grey camouflage print. Rafe, Mars, and Sinchita piled into a second cab. When they reached the stadium, the stage door was open and the security guard on duty instantly recognized Rocky. "No news about your brother?" he asked. "Not yet," Rocky shook his hand. "We're just going to have a look around." The guard waved them on and went back to reading his newspaper. The backstage area was deserted. Rocky led the way behind massive towers of amplifiers and speakers and past the empty seats where the band's orchestra was to sit. They entered a long hall that brought them to the pop group's dressing rooms. Rocky pointed to three doors with purple stars. "Ray had the first door," he explained. "I was in the middle and Frankie had the other one." The dressing rooms were spacious, fitted with full-length mirrors, surrounded by bare light bulbs, wardrobes, and comfortable sofas. One by one, they checked other rooms and returned to Romeo's. Rocky scowled. "I just noticed something. Ray's guitar isn't here." He checked inside the wardrobe and shrugged. He wouldn't go anywhere without that guitar. And that's not all, Alvin gave his pointed chin a rap. Romeo's room is the only one with a window. He carried a chair across to the high, narrow window, climbed up on it, and pushed it open. Beyond the window was a narrow ledge leading to a fire escape. They took turns to peer out. Willing looked at Rocky. "Who chose the dressing rooms?" she asked him. "Who decided that Romeo would have the one with the window?" "Wow, you are a detective," Rocky grinned. His brow furrowed as he considered his answers. "I think it was Maxie." So Maxie really made it easy for Romeo to escape, Mas thought aloud. Sinchita shot Rocky a mocking look. "Can't you really imagine your brother crawling out through that window with a guitar in one hand?" she asked. "The ledge is very narrow. What if he'd slip? He'd have broken his neck." Rocky glared back at her. "What are you getting at?" "Nothing," she met his gaze with a cynical smile. "I just can't see a pop star sneaking through a window like that unless someone was forcing him, that's all." "But I've already told you," Rocky snapped. "Maxie wouldn't have had anything to do with Ray's disappearance." And he threw her a taunting smile of his own. "Frankie, maybe, but not Maxie." "Or you, Rocky," Sinchita snorted and walked away. "Or you." When the bouncer hailed the cab in the main street, Azizu streaked out and stopped 1-2. "Follow my friend in that taxi," he told the driver. "He forgot his wallet." "Okay," the driver shot him a suspicious glance in the rearview mirror. "Are you sure you've got money, kid?" Azizu waved Rocky's money in his fist and settled back in his seat. This could be a wild goose chase, he thought, or it could be the best break the detective could hope for. He wondered what Alvin and the others were doing and wished he had his mobile phone. He also wondered why people never thought about the wild duck chase. Azizu's eyes followed the bouncer's cab. For several minutes, it had driven along the wide main street of the city. Suddenly, it swung off into a network of narrow lanes. The buildings were becoming shabbier. Huge signs announced that new developments, office and apartment blocks, would soon replace the dilapidated old structures. Azizu saw a demolition team at work, clearing a roll of ancient warehouse. When the bouncer's taxi swung into the curb, Azizu told the driver to keep going. "Don't stop yet," he ordered. "But I thought you said you had your friend's wallet," he argued. Azizu caught a glimpse of the bouncer hurrying into a building with a faded brass 49 above the entrance. "Go round the next corner and stop there," he told the driver. Counting out the fare, Azizu shoved the rest of the money into his pocket and ran back to where he'd last seen the bouncer. He looked up at the rusted street sign Half Moon Street and wondered what part of town he was in. Flattening himself against the wall, he peered around the corner into Half Moon Street. It was empty. No cars, no people, no sign of life. Keeping to the doorways, ready to dart for cover, Azizu crept along until he reached the entrance to number 49. The front door was open a crack. He climbed the steps and eased himself inside. Somewhere in the gloom, he could hear the bouncer's footsteps. They sounded as though the big man was climbing the flat wooden steps just inside the front door. His heart pounding wildly. Azizu tiptoed forward and began his ascent. He heard trees jangle in the darkness above, and a door groaned open. A deep, growling voice mumbled something and then laughed out loud. Seconds later, the door slammed. The bolt was rammed home and the keys rattled again. The big man came thundering down the stairs and Azizu looked round desperately. He ducked into the deep shadows at the back of the landing and watched a bouncer hurry past, less than half a meter away. When the main door clanged shut below, Azizu counted off 60 seconds, his breathing steadier. He climbed one more flight and picked his way along a passage. He saw it almost at once. One door had a brand new bolt secured by a shiny padlock. He shook it as hard as he could, but it was too strong for him to force. A startling sound reached him from the other side of the door. Azizu ran his hands over the surface of the door until he found the small round hole that had been drilled through it. He stood on tiptoe and squinted through. Inside, wild eyes, eyed and fearful, was Romeo Doggett.